Welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of the Tiny Room for Elephants Happy Hour, where we get together every week and just kind of talk about music, art, culture, and as Yael likes to say, shoot the shit. We have a very special guest with us today, all the way from the West Coast, legendary artist already, Dewey Saunders, make some noise.
Already,
what is up? Thank you for having me.
I was just saying before we went live that you are our first guest from another coast. So
yeah, high five from the West Coast. What is up? It's super sunny here, you know, sunny vibes, and it's probably coming down on the East Coast right now. It's snowing right now, probably.
We needed those sunny vibes in this middle of the snowstorm.
Honey. Bring them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's another sunny ass day in LA. It's like the first day of spring every day of winter. I feel like I'm still getting used to it too, though. Like I've been out here for like 3 years, and I still don't even know how to dress. I'm like, what month is it? Like every day is the same, but it's also the desert, so it gets like cold as shit at night. So, you know, it's definitely a little bit of an adjustment. But yeah, the mild winters are kind of nice because I'm a Florida boy actually. So I like the warm weather. Like that's my speed for sure. You know, so it's nice to be out here.
Cool. So we normally open up, you know, you don't really know everyone on the team. So we'll open up, let everyone kind of introduce themselves and start with a question to the group. My question to the group kind of in honor of our guest is, what's your favorite album cover? So who are you? Actually, what you drinking and what's your favorite album cover? I'll start with Dane.
Oh,
that's a good one.
Yes. Jeez.
Apparently
I'm drinking champagne, which is... Thank you, Omar. I'm currently drinking champagne, which is great in a snowstorm. Never thought I'd be doing that right now. And man, my favorite album cover. There's so many. I think I can give you three, right? I don't know. I can't give you one. Like one of my favorite album covers just in general as a group is all of the Bell album covers. I think they're all awesome. Like just phenomenal pieces of work by itself, front and back. I have two of them framed in my studio. And then also from a hip hop perspective, like on the hip hop side of things, which I love, one of my favorite album covers is the Bizarre Ride. It was a CD, obviously, and it was a cover, but then when you opened it up, it was a whole big roller coaster thing.
Yeah.
And first of all, you don't even get that anymore with like album cover and CD packages or whatever. But when you opened it, I think the tape too, when you opened it up, it was like a whole bigger piece of art. You know what I'm saying? Like them at the top of a roller coaster or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah. Love that.
What about you, Yaya?
So I'm drinking, you guys know I love my box wine, so I have my Bota box, Sauvignon Blanc. That's the only box wine that I really, really like. And album covers. So think about my dad. He had a really large album collection, and I feel like the artwork that I was always drawn to was anything by Santana. I always... Yeah. The Santana artwork always had just a lot of going on, a lot of different levels and elements to it. And whenever you looked at it, you could find something new, which I really enjoyed. And then, of course, in honor of our guest, I am in love with Anderson .Paak. Is it Malibu? Is it Malibu, right? The whole collage feel I really love. And Dewey is one of the best at it. So that's
wow. Fun. Thank you.
Glue
good
room.
Pick.
Glue room. What's your favorite?
I'm like a huge Atmosphere fan, so I really like You Can't Imagine How Much Fun We're Having, just because like says like a million things on one photo, and I love photography, so it's like a photo, so dig that. And I'm drinking again Lagunitas, this time a little something.
Jason, what about you?
Favorite, yeah. One of my favorites, and I feel like, I don't know, yeah. It's definitely Bitches Brew from Miles Davis. I love that. And I got it on vinyl. It's at the studio, but it opens up and it's like a whole like wide landscape of it continues, you know, it's just beautiful. Oh, so wow. Love that. Yes, I'm Jason, and I'm drinking Hootie by Six Point. And that's
hazy. Love that.
And I'm it's good. I'm enjoying it.
So before I ask Dewey, because we'll probably dive into some stuff from there, I'll let you know what I'm drinking. I got this kombucha grapefruit with a hint of thyme, and
Flying Embers. Cover, yes,
yeah, Flying Embers. Yeah, yep. And my favorite album cover. You guys gave me crap for this when I said it was one of my albums I take on the island with me. But Kanye Graduation, Takashi Murakami. I love had some special experiences with that album and the artwork. So yeah, that's mine. What about you, Dewey?
Well, first of all, I wanted to point out that the artist that did the Santana cover also did the Miles Davis Bitches Brew cover.
What? And,
wow.
They said we're kindred.
And basically, it was this really prolific painter named Mati Klarwine. And yeah, he did Bitches Brew. He did Abraxas for Santana and a couple other ones too. But he had this very hyper complex, realistic style that was informed by like his psychedelic usage, which is really interesting. Yeah. So those are actually a couple of my favorite covers too. But I always have to throw in the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper, because that is like the epitome of a mixed media cover for me, even though it's not a collage. It's actually a photograph of all the characters printed out life-size and then arranged in a big room. And there's actually like a really funny story about it too. Apparently it was a nightmare to arrange for whoever the director for photography was. Sure. And they were like hanging people and like trying to like move them all around. And then in the front, you can see the Beatles made themselves into wax sculptures in the very front row of their younger selves. So it looks like it's like a collage, but it's really a life-size photograph. And I just love that cover. It was, I believe, designed and directed by the duo called Hypnosis, who did a bunch of other covers too, 10cc and some like other psychedelic like rock classic covers. So yeah, a little bit of fun history for you.
This is like a whole show, Dewey.
Yes.
You could just like talk about album covers and art, because I feel like
right?
You know,
yeah,
to it, and the little behind the scenes nuggets we don't know.
Yeah, there's so many interesting stories too. And just because that's what I do, I just collect books about rock covers or just the greatest covers of all time and kind of like dive into the stories behind those. And there's always like a funny thing that happens because, you know, making artwork for really big personalities, there tends to be like some funny stories involved too. So it's actually funny because I've been thinking about what to do a podcast about for myself, and I can wax on about album artwork forever. So that's kind of, you just gave me a good idea.
That's what it is.
That would be great.
So I think we got Mike in the waiting room, so we can throw the, over
just
a drink.
Hit him with the question.
Who was that? What did you say?
I said, when he comes on, just hit him with the question. Don't give him any time.
Yeah. So I wanted to ask you before we do that, Dewey, who are some of like the artists, you know what I mean, that you've worked with, for people that don't know? And that's what you do. You know, you make covers.
Yeah. Well, I think that I'm most well known for Anderson .Paak's Malibu cover, but I've been working with Anderson since before Malibu, I did the Venice cover as well. And then after Malibu on some like more corporate projects with like Vans, like House of Vans and some like mural type stuff with Anderson. So he's probably one of my favorite people to work with, but I did the Future cover for The Wizard that came out in 2019. And just a slew of album covers that kind of span across different genres. For like hardcore fans, I did Turnstiles, Time and Space. For reggae fans, I did Chronix, Chronology. For like European, like dance producer, like hip hop vibes, like Jero Vandal, I did his anthology cover. So basically my work like started in the hip hop space, but has kind of branched out into even like pop and rock and stuff like that. So it's really like, I'm all about if the music is good, like it doesn't really matter what genre it is. I think that we're in a time where genre doesn't really matter. And the best artists are almost genres within themselves. So I try to work with people that are just like super interesting and bringing something new, you know?
That's what I was
going to
might want to let Mike in, but I was going to let Mike in,
but we can, you know, continue.
Let Mike in. He's going to come in on 10.
Mike! Oh, hey. You're in the guest room today.
Okay. Oh, Mike switched it up.
Hey, what's up, y'all?
Hey.
I'm sorry, I'm late, man. Long day for me today, man.
Gosh.
It's all good. You're just in time for your segment, man.
Was that?
Just in time for a drink, man.
Time for your segment.
Oh, perfect timing. I ain't even got a drink. That's how long the day. I'm like, if I get a drink, I'll probably pass out. So forgive me, man. Oh, man. I'm so damn
tired, man. All right, so to over a drink, tell us about your day, Mike.
Because I have to know, you came in like a bat out of hell, Mike. And I got to know, I saw a post that you were up at 4 a.m. getting at it. Wifey was asleep. She took a snow day. Was that today or was that yesterday?
Well, it was yesterday and today.
Okay.
So I've been up since 1:15 this morning.
Mike, can you tell Dewey what you do for a living so everybody can
move in? So I'm a videographer for Fox News, Fox 29 here in the city. So I run around chase the news all day.
Yeah.
So the last 2 days it's been snow coverage. I didn't hear you. I thought you said something. So the last 2 days it's been snow coverage. And so I've been just out driving from 1 o'clock in the morning till 11 o'clock, just roving around.
Did you see anything interesting?
No, it's just no, ain't nobody outside.
No
car accidents. That's it.
Yeah.
Other idiots on the road will be like, "Why are you out here? Why ain't you home?" And it's like, it's 2 feet of snow out here. Go home. So that's it. That's been it, man. And yesterday they ran me up to Trenton. And then they said, once I got to Trenton, they said, "Oh, can you go down to Wilmington, Delaware?" I'm like, "Shit, I just got to Trenton, and it's snowing outside." So I had to turn around, and they don't want me to get on the highway because the highway's plowed, right? So you got to take all the side streets. So I had to go
for the creative, and in case you find something to stop.
Correct.
Correct, right?
And the pictures look prettier on the street because they're not plowed yet. You got extra snow, all that. So I had to go from Trenton, which normally on the highway would take like 25 minutes. Oh, I took, you know, no highways in the GPS. It took me 2 hours and 15 minutes to get from Trenton to Wilmington. My body was so beat up by the time I got out that car.
You don't have any questions for Dewey, or
I don't have not a question for Dewey. I don't know what the hell Dewey does. I don't know. Listen, let me tell you something, man.
But that's nothing new.
That's Mike.
I'm completely unprepared for today because today was just an instant replay of yesterday.
So go get a drink and relax.
Get a drink, relax. I'll ask Dewey some questions for you.
I do got my daughter brought me an iced tea. This is some peach
drink, bro. That's not worthy of your day, man.
That's no good.
Don't count.
That's no good. You need to get warm. You just came in from shoveling snow after all that. So all
right, let me go. I'm gonna go put a shot in it. Let me go grab it. I'm gonna pop the top open. And I'm gonna go get a shot of something. And put a shot of something in there. Dewey, I'm sorry, brother. I feel so bad that I came so unprepared, man.
You can't do this to the mic. He's the most honest, awesome guy you ever meet.
No worries, bro.
That was the flavor of the
who needed and, this happy hour.
And I don't know if it's my internet or somebody else's internet, but y'all freezing up all over the place on me.
Oh, Mike, you in the guest room? You in the guest room, Mike?
Got that guest room internet.
Reception.
Well. Definitely yours, babe. Sorry.
Yeah, it could be mine. It's just that kind of day.
Well, go get your cocktail and
go get your drink, man.
All right, I'll be right back.
Okay.
Oh, man.
Yeah, nobody said we not real, okay?
We are out there hustling, so. That was great. I'll try to bring it back to where we were. Dewey, we were talking about the different artists you work with, and I kind of, you know, you would mention Turnstile, you'd mention just kind of like, you know, you started in hip hop, but it's kind of different artists, and then even you look at like some of the brands you would mention Vans, you worked with Urban Outfitters, Rolling Loud, Ray-Ban,
William Shakespeare.
And Philly Act.
Thank you.
Shakespeare, right? Yep. Vacationer as well. And the homie, Dale. Shout out to Alex Dale.
Exactly.
So my question is, what is it you think about your art that like draws such like a diverse group, kind of, right? Like from the brands to the artists, even the artists alone are super diverse.
I don't know, man. I feel like I'm in a lucky position because I've created such a personal style. Whereas in the past, like I still, you know, I feel like the album kind of dictates how I'm going to approach it visually. But within that, within all of the covers I've done, you can still tell that they have my hand behind them. And yeah, I feel like the way that I work really resonates with people, and through the Anderson .Paak Malibu cover, which is funny because when it came out nothing really happened, but over time it has become my biggest calling card and the biggest blessing that I could ever imagine. So there are so many kids, and I can remember when I was in high school I would like hang up posters in my room and shit. And like, I was a underground hip hop head. So I can only imagine, and all these kids that are hitting me up confirm this, but they grew up with Malibu and like in high school and shit.
Mm-hmm.
And basically put the poster that was in the vinyl or whatever and framed it on their wall. And I still get photos of this, but because of Anderson's meteoric rise, that cover got a lot of eyes on it, and subsequently a lot of kids became a fan of my artwork, and a lot of bands really you know, saw that, and they saw the future cover. And I feel like within the, you know, within the graphic design world, there's so much competition, and like I feel lucky to have a unique perspective and like a unique way of image making. So I feel a lot of people kind of like, you know, relate to what I do. And I feel like my art attracts the right artists as well, which is interesting too. So like my art attracts like interesting artists, like not really like square type of people or like normies. Like, you know, I have like really interesting, unique artists coming out of the woodwork hitting me up. So I feel like that's kind of what my lane is like really working with people that are serious about the visuals, and to basically kind of like bring them into my world and explore their sonic world.
Can I ask a question?
You talked
about how you put your personal style into it as well. What's it like on the other end? Like, you know, from this amazing album cover, these amazing album covers come out, and then you see other artists, graphic designers, like you see your style like replicated in a way. And, you know, it happens with, you know, with everything, right? With all mediums of art. Like, what's it like then when now, like,
that Future album set off almost a genre of like album covers, man. Like people trying to make my perspective.
It's interesting. Yeah. Well, you know, there's nothing new under the sun, and everything that I do comes from a lot of references too. But I think that in this social, this like age of like social media, it's important to deep, to like really dig deep for your references. So that's what makes like hip hop producers stand differently from each other. Like you have like Madlib or Dilla, and they just, they're digging so deep that their references are deeper. And like, yeah, kids can copy the collage style, but if their only reference is like the Malibu cover and they don't know anything about art history, then it's going to look very flat and very surfacey. Whereas the sources and imagery that I bring into my work, because I like study different themes, it's more visually rich and more conceptual than like somebody that's just like kind of like copying and pasting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I without going too deep with it, I definitely noticed
Mike, I think you on mute.
Mike, you on
mute. Can I chime in for a second?
Yeah.
First of all, man, I just realized like that Malibu album cover is amazing, dude. Now that I know who you are, I'm like, oh shit, this dude is like, I should have did some research.
Welcome to the show, Mike.
Welcome. Hey,
thank you. I appreciate the invite. Hey man, can I ask what other album covers you've done? Like, do you have a ton of them under your belt, or you know, is it 10? Is it 25?
You missed that part of the show, Mike. Come on.
I know, I'm getting caught up. Give me 30 seconds.
Okay.
All right.
All right.
So how about I can share the screen and show a couple that I really like that weren't just covers but the artwork associated.
Yeah.
So let me do that. Here we go. So this is, I believe, actually, I will let you talk about it, Dewey.
Yeah, so this is the inside of the Malibu cover. This is like the gatefold that, or like the poster that would come with the LP. So it's like related to the cover directly, but it's the like underwater version of it.
So rich.
God. Yeah, so this is a lot of the times kids have this poster in their rooms, and I see like, you know, photos of like this framed up a lot. Like, it's pretty cool. It just looks dope in person too. Like, it's just a big, you know, 12 by 24 inch poster.
Nice.
And then you have so this is for this band called Dust Bowl Revival. They're like a folk rock band, and this is the gatefold as well. So like, I love like doing like a kind of a simpler cover, and then like inside of the LP, I kind of think of like the packaging almost like these like psychedelic rock albums from like the 70s or something. So I try to make it like really like rich. And this is one of my favorites because there's so many like layers, and the layering really creates like this depth or like this perspective of it kind of going back into infinity.
I feel that.
And then, yeah, Save a Capstad, one of my favorite bands. They're from South Africa.
Oh.
And they are on Mellow Music Group, which is one of my favorite hip hop labels that has been like diversifying their genres. And this is the second cover I've done for them. So this is their follow up LP, which is amazing. I'd highly recommend it. But I really like working with them because I get to kind of do like a wild style, and lately my work has been getting a little bit more abstract, but keeping like a hero image in the middle just so it kind of makes sense, but really kind of making the cutouts kind of bleed and melt into each other.
amazing.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Your work is so good, man.
Thank you so much.
The party, man, but like, damn, man, I'm glad I showed up, man, because this shit is official, bro. Like,
I appreciate that.
And like, I seen the Malibu album cover, you know, and admired it. So the fact that I'm sitting here, you know, rapping with you and having a drink with you, man, this is a pleasure, man. I'm glad I can listen to you talk, man.
Did you get a drink, Mike?
Yeah, I just threw a little shot in here, man. So this is peach oolong tea with a couple of some peach, you know, it's some peaches. It's oolong tea with some peaches inside of it. And I just threw a shot of vodka down in there.
Call that the snow day surprise. And
obviously, you swirled it around, right?
Gave it a little shake up. You know what I mean?
Okay. Here we go.
And I'm at the party. Sometimes you just got to drink what's at the table, man. You can't really be picky.
Yeah. Hey, somebody showed up with champagne. What can I say, man? Like, you know, I just.
That's what I'm saying.
Sound like a high idea, but I was looking at that last one and noticing how much the orchid looks like a bee with the bee on it there and how they're like.
Yeah.
Similar, like, I don't know, like structures and like shapes to each other.
Well, I'm glad you noticed that because that's why I love collage so much too, because once you start chopping up and like random combinations happen, like on your desk in real time, there are so many like connections, and like the abstract stuff is really fun too, because a lot of like plant forms are similar to animal forms, and you can really like rapidly with like a simple juxtaposition, like just change an entire picture and like meaning. And like my favorite thing to do is make an illusion that looks real and kind of like makes me laugh. I'm just like, all right, like the illusion has been achieved. It works.
I have a question. Dewey, are you physically making all of these, or are some of them just digital?
Yeah, so basically all my client work is finished in a digital process. Like a lot of the pieces are cut by hand and scanned in, but for client work, it would be absolutely insane for me to try to do it by hand and then adjust for changes and revisions. So as much as I love hand cut collage, in a corporate or like a label environment, when changes are needed on the fly, everything has to be digitized. So basically the Photoshop file will behave similar to like the canvas I'm like collaging onto, whereas I'm just moving around like cut pieces of paper and not really playing around with like filters or like layering effects too much. It's really keeping the analog process intact in the digital environment.
Nice.
Are you shooting all those images?
All those images. The images are, they're from highly secret sources.
As they should be. As they should
be. I dig it.
Yeah, man. I mean, like, if you want to like start like collaging, like National Geographics are where every collage artist starts with. And that's just something that, you know, you can really have fun with. But in the corporate environment for labels and everything, every image has to be licensed, because these lawyers are going to scrutinize and they're going to want to know where everything comes from. So there definitely is a gray area, but unfortunately, a lot of the times the lawyers on these labels don't really want to like play in that area at all. So basically my new strategy is to shoot all the images myself, and a lot of the covers that I have coming out are all my own photos that I've used for the collage.
That's cool.
Yeah. Which is a big
level. Was that?
I was a photographer. Yeah, like my roots before designer photography, and now I'm like relearning the art, basically.
For sure.
Yeah. It's been fun.
So, all right. So I think
it takes it to a next level too. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like
It really does. You know, I never really thought of myself as a photographer, but I was really just limiting myself. So as soon as I like stopped doing that, I one of my newest covers I just designed is all my own photos and probably one of my favorite pieces. So I'm like in totally in like new territory right now. And it's like, yeah, it feels great. I'm in control of all the images. So yeah,
that's cool. I was going to ask if you felt like restricted at all with that process, like it being that way, but.
Well, a part of my style was like the old magazine, like coloring of the photos and like the vintage feel to it. So basically like if it's not like a huge label that's going to scrutinize every image, I'm still going to use cut paper and like old magazines that I find. But it's nice to have the option to like use my own photos, or like I have a ton of photographer friends that are like just dumping huge like folders of images of like random stuff that I can just like use for work. So it's just about like re-examining where I'm like pulling from and just like spreading out like and digging deeper, just like we were talking about.
It's almost cool. like producers who's looking for a sample, a beat or something, something to sample. Yeah. You just in magazines and in,
yeah,
you know, any kind of periodicals you can find looking for images. Digging.
I mean, honestly, it's the same shit. I feel like produced like sampling is like audible collage making. And that's why I love Madlib, because I feel like he's making collages with sound. But it really is how you flip the sample, or like what you do with the image that you find. So it's almost like we all have the same materials to pull from, but it's how you like remix it, how you chop it, how you loop it, how you flip it.
His new album is nuts.
Yeah.
I listen to it, but I like, I need to go deep, deep.
I guess that's a perfect transition to go into this music review. So we're very, you know, Tiny Room's a art collective, but it's also very music driven. I'm a producer. Jason's a producer. Dane's a producer. Alex, Mike, and Yaya all love music.
Yaya's a singer.
Yeah, come on.
Yaya, the voice of the room.
Especially when I get drunk, okay?
So Tennessee today, she'd be probably singing.
Tennessee, Yaya got the pipes.
Right? So we normally review some music every once in a while on here. This time we decided to go back. I believe this was per Dean's request, if I'm not mistaken.
I had a conversation with my engineer, John Smeltz, and I think Jason was there too. And we were talking, he had just watched the documentary on Netflix. Maybe Jason wasn't there. We had just watched the documentary on Netflix on Sam Cooke. And I was like, yo, I think one of my favorite like pieces of music is this live album. Because it's like, he's one of our greatest singer-songwriters like ever. And his voice is unmistakable, but this album was just like a little bit different. Like when you hear like Sam Cooke singing in movies, a lot of it sometimes is taken from this album. Like when you watch Ali and it's like, it comes on and Sam Cooke, it's like, that's all like reminiscent, because it's at the same place. It was in Miami when he was fighting for the first title and all that. So I thought it would be apropos to go back. You know what I'm saying? And yeah. So I don't know. I'm biased. Like, obviously I love it. First off, like just to hear like Miami 1960, I think 3. And I'm not sure how big the club is, but it just felt like really intimate and close. Like, you can hear the people, you can hear the women, like, love you can hear the women, like, looking at Sam, which is, like, I don't even get what I'm saying, but, like, you can hear them. And, like, the call and responses are, like, yeah. I've never heard call and response that sounded so good. Like, yeah. They must have been all singers, too. But it was just, like, like just that feel. Like, I listened to it with my ear pods in, like, for the first time, and like, recently. And I was, like, oh, man, this is, like, so intimate. Like, also, like, my last thing, just sonically, like, I feel like they really got the low end theory. I feel like the low end of that, like, was a little more like if you know Sam Cooke, his image at the time was like more like Black Frank Sinatra, like, you know what I mean? Even though he had that in him. But like I'm saying, the bottom end was turned up. It just made me feel like I was partying like in a different time, but also that the same principles a lot, you know what I'm saying? We need bass. We need, you know what I'm saying? Like, need that feeling and shit. So, I mean, like I said, I'm biased, but I'm curious to, you know what I mean, to hear everybody else, you know what I mean?
I mean, obviously, I loved it. I mean, his voice is just like, it's like butter. I mean, it is just so smooth and rich, and I mean, I could just listen to him all day. And
it sounded like he had a few too. Like he had a couple of drinks.
yeah.
And the lyrics, the song, it's just like, you know, it's so good in the way that, you know, he writes about love and fun. It's just very refreshing to hear. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, this isn't really like a review, right? But
my favorite parts.
Yeah, I mean, the Sam Cooke live performances I've seen have always been like the like TV shows he's done or whatever. So like to hear this, like he is so smooth on the TV shows, and it's like such a controlled, like smooth thing. And here he is, so much grit in his voice, and it's such a bigger range of like emotion. And then like you said, Dane, to hear the audience so clearly in it. I looked into it a little bit, and there's a few like remasters they released where like they mixed the audience down, I think, a lot in the second one, and they included some like overdubs to fix shit, you know, because I think the label thought it was a little too raucous and live, you know, they wanted more like pop star Sam Cooke album. And then I think there was a third one that kind of split the difference, and that's what we hear now. But I think a few times you can hear a little shift, like it sounds like a vocal overdub or something was like placed in there. So it's kind of
interesting. That's the problem here. I didn't hear that.
They even waited to release it until 1985 because they didn't like how it sounded. So like it even took so long to even get to the mainstream as it was. It was pretty crazy.
Yeah, they thought it was a little too raucous for his image.
But yeah, and then like even after releasing that, they're like, maybe just a little bit. We'll find it a little bit.
Wow. Well,
I hadn't even really listened to a lot of Sam Cooke prior to this album. Like, I knew a couple of his songs, but I've never like went into a Sam Cooke album. Let's put it that way. And honestly, I listened to it on a wax system in my company car today while I was driving around. So I really, even when I was hearing it, I was like, I need to listen to this in my own car where I could turn it up. And I just didn't get that opportunity today. But that being said, I mean, his vocals, the energy that was in the album completely drew me in. It was like, it was good enough, even on that wax system, it was good enough that I was like, yo, I need to listen to this again. And then I noticed there was a lyric that he had on there. Could a matchbox hold my clothes? I don't remember which song it was. But it was funny to me because I heard that Albert King is a blues singer. And he has it's a song called Can a Matchbox Hold My Clothes? And it was ill to me. Now, I don't know who said it first, but it was ill to me to hear that even back then, artists were borrowing from each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? It was like, oh shit, like I heard the Albert King album. It's an Albert King and Stevie Ray Vaughan. It's a live album. It's a great album if you want something to listen to.
Okay. Well,
it's a great album. So you know, Sam, I mean, this is the guy, Sam Cooke, that owned his own masters, had his own record company, owned distribution. I mean, he came out of gospel, but then, like, you know, he's writing songs, and then, you know, the Rolling Stones are like, yo, could we sing that song? He's like, yeah, go ahead. You know what I mean? So he was, like, at a next level in his career, but also in his business. So, I mean, you know, we can get into how he passed away, but that's not really the thing. It's about this album, but it's like, he was at a, like, he only had a couple of albums out, like, you know, before he passed that were like, you know, that's why this was so important. And it was just a shame that it didn't come out to 1985, you know?
But that's what it was. And then when I listened to it, you know, like I said, that hearing that lyric on this live album, I was like, I wonder if he borrowed it from Albert King or did Albert King borrow it from him and make a whole song after the fact. But whatever the case, it was cool to hear how these how artists even back then were borrowing from each other. And it was good to, it was cool to hear, like, you know, because this Sam Cooke, I've heard his name my whole life, but I've never taken the time to go listen to his work. You know, I hear it on a movie, I hear it pop into my in and out, but it was probably the album I needed to be like, yo, man, go do your Sam Cooke research.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm loving that.
Yeah. Oh, man.
That's good. Yeah, I give the... oh, go ahead.
No, you
I
was go.
Say, I feel like everything on there is a classic, you know?
Yeah. That's all. Yeah.
I mean, and he wrote all those songs for the most part, you know what I'm saying? And some of the best parts, I keep talking about it, obviously, I love it, are like when he's like kind of like talking and telling his story and then going into another, like, yeah. Some of those transitions are like just immaculate, man. Like,
and it was like, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, do we go ahead, brother?
Well, I definitely gave it a spin like twice yesterday, and I only know Sam Cooke's recorded stuff in studio, so hearing the live album was insane because it was like raw and uncut, and Sam's voice did have the grit. It was smooth and gritty, kind of like
Houseway.
Sandpaper. But he also, like, the audience was a big part of the energy in the room that night, and it was palpable. Even in like whatever version that we're listening to today, it was, the energy is like bleeding through the speaker, and like the band was rock solid. Everybody was super tight. Yeah. And like, you could even like smell the smoke in the room. Like, yeah. It was a fucking party. Cats were getting lit. You can smell the booze by listening to the album. And it's like, it's loud, it's raucous, it's very, it's like Sam Cooke unhinged. And that's why it wasn't released till the 80s, because it's really like, it's really Sam, you know? And he did have a couple of drinks. And it was that real saucy Sam Cooke. And I was like, damn, like, I'm glad I gave this a listen. And there's this music writer doing an exercise on Twitter, and he's basically listening to a new album that he'd never heard every day. So I kind of like incorporated that Sam Cooke album into the same practice. And basically I felt like, I just like wrote like a little tweet about it, but it was something about Sam Cooke's voice being like smoke, just like wrapping around the room, like wrapping around the instruments, and just being like this all pervading, like gritty, smooth smoke that he was like, kind of like wrapping the crowd with. Like, it was just like so intimate. But yeah, that's my review.
That's, that's so a great beautiful review.
But you described it exactly how you felt, dude.
Yes.
Like I said, even on that wax system that I listened to, it was his voice was so rich. It was like, yo, like you wanted to be in that room. Like, it drew you in. You was like, yo, this is a party. Like, I want to be at this party. You know what I mean? It was one of them shows, like, you hear something, you're like, damn, I wish I was at that show. That was that, you felt that way.
At any show.
There's another live recording, and it's like him live at the Cobra Cabana, totally different. So it's like, totally different. It's like Frank Sinatra. It's like, hey guys, it's like, it's a swinging, like a swinging affair. You know what I'm saying? It's totally different.
Nah, this was an uptown album. Funny. He was uptown at Harlem. It was different crowd. Different crowd. Different crowd up there.
I used to play bass with this singer-songwriter with this drummer, and we would call ourselves the Golden Eagles. It was Jason Egger and the Golden Eagles. And we would do a lot of like soul stuff. And just like listening to this live, like, made me realize like how foundational Sam Cooke is. Like, that's like where all of that live shit came from for like even all these days, you know, like, and just hearing how the band would kind of sing, it took me back to the days playing with those guys. And in some ways, not to say we're anywhere near as tight as they were, but
also how gospel has, you know, like, gospel music is the foundation of really, really good R&B as well.
Yeah,
I mean, he came out of the church. He came out of gospel music, and it was a big deal when he like was like, "Yeah, I'm gonna try this other thing over here." You know what I'm saying? Because that was not the music that you would be playing. And, you know, but you see so many of them between, like, you know, you watch Sam Cooke or even like Ray Charles, like, and it's like, yo, that's like, that's the real thing that touches you. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's the feeling that you get in like soul music. You know what I'm saying? So it's,
even today, a lot of artists that come out of the church, their energy, their voice, their performance, like, it's so much richer than somebody, it seems anyway, than people who are just straight into secular music and just do their thing. Like, it's something about being, you know, groomed in the church that when they get out that church, I don't know if it's because they be bound up and they just be ready to rip when they get in the street. Oh, they let loose when they hit in the street.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, Anderson .Paak grew up playing drums in the Baptist church. Like, he just, playing in church makes you tight because it's like there's no show off business. You just you play, you do your role, and you play like real tight. And I feel like some of the best musicians come out of playing in church. But
sure,
you also listen.
Definitely in Philly.
If you follow a pastor who's like speaking over you or someone who's like flowing with it, you listen and you got to follow with them. So that breeds, I think, a good musician. You know,
Jason comes out of the church too. I don't know.
Yeah, they are. They usually more plugged into what's going on around them. The musicians that come out of churches and
that was giving itself mohawks. What's happening? What's going on?
That's J Dog. That's cool. Look, J Dog took it up a notch. Y'all wasn't ready.
But we cut each other's hair in our household, and there was an accident that happened this week. I don't normally say
it. He said it's an accident. That's what his wife told him. His wife was like, oops. Now, it wasn't an accident.
I'm kind of loving it. And I'm going to save it down to this length again. You know, I love it.
I love it.
Fun. That looks cool.
He got a beard on his head and one on his chin.
Oh man. Alex is heading back outside from
the Mike.
His daughter's killing him. I love his daughter. She's running in and out of his head.
Dewey, what are you listening to now?
What am I listening to? Let me see. I've been putting together these like playlists every week that are just all over the place, but there's this knowledge flip of this Krungbin song that just came out today. I was just like really digging that all day. Going through the Madlib album, Cleo Soul is one of my favorite singers right now. You guys know Cleo Soul?
No, I don't. I'm taking notes.
So good. Yeah, y'all should take some notes. Let's see, as far as like contemporary stuff, like I'm like an old school dude, so I really be listening to like Marvin Gaye and shit all the time. But yeah, the Madlib, Salt is like my favorite band like ever. Lots of reggae, Gregory Isaacs.
Love Gregory Isaacs.
There's a soul band out of San Diego called The Sacred Souls, and they're like every song is just a deep cut, some lowrider shit. Nice.
Did you say
B-Sacred? Yeah, the two E's, The Sacred Souls. And yeah, I've been like really listening to a lot of jazz shit lately too. Cal Jader, for some like vibes. And then let's see, this dude Liam Bailey, he's from the UK. He has a lot of like reggae style shit, but he's all over the place. He's a really dope dude. But my musical taste is all over the place. I like to just kind of like make mixes for myself. So when I'm working like in the studio, it's just like a big variety. It kind of depends, like a lot of rock shit sometimes, a lot of like samba or like, you know, Brazilian, like bossa nova, stuff like that.
Bro, I love it, man.
When you're working on an album cover, like, are you listening to like that specific music or are you like all over the place still?
Well, that's a good question. I definitely start with the actual music, and if they don't supply it, I'll like do like my homework and like find like something similar to get the vibe. But yeah, I really like world music and just like, you know, like Afrobeat, like Fela Kuti and reggae shit. Yeah, I'm just like, I really am all over the place. Like, I came from a hip hop background, but then I think when I started to discover what everybody was sampling. I was like, oh, like Tribe sampled every Minnie Riperton song. I'm like, I love Minnie Riperton.
They really did.
I think it's a beautiful musical education, because a lot of the producers we grew up listening to were digging their parents' records. So it's like, we really like to, if you do your homework, you can really like get down to what the inspiration was of a lot of our favorite hip hop songs. And I just love like finding samples. I'm like, you know, I could see why this was sampled, because the original song is so fire. And you know, it's just it just relates to what I do visually too. So I'm like really sympathetic to sampling as well. You know,
second that.
Yeah, keep sampling a lot.
So we got about 8 minutes left in this. A question, I suppose, for you. I know Yaya was curious about some of this as well. I think from someone, I guess, from slightly afar, Philadelphian, let's say, you know what I mean, that kind of watch you start to like bubble, you know what I mean, in the underground scene, if you will, right? It appears, and I know it's not entirely true, but it appears like you moved to Cali, blew up, and started a clothing line. Kind of want to know, like, you know, what got you to Cali? What made you want to move there? And tell us a little bit about that shit you're rocking.
Right.
Yeah. So long story short, after I did Malibu, I was like really feeling that I had to be in proximity to the clients that I was working with. So Los Angeles was always on the radar. Basically, it took me a couple of years to get out here. After Malibu dropped, I was like, you know, I really want to be in the context that I want to be working in. And even though everything is mobile these days, a lot of music industry shit is networking. And like, I don't even want to say that word because I kind of hate it, but it's really like making friends and maintaining relationships. So, I wanted to be in a place where my work would kind of pop off more. And basically it really helps to be like in town, like whether it's like New York or Los Angeles or, you know, Paris or whatever, but I kind of wanted to be in one of these like cultural centers. So basically I'm glad that it appears that way. It's always a, you know, it's always an uphill grind, you know, and it's, I'm a big fan of like steady progress. So I've been, you know, taking it one step at a time, but landing the Future cover was a really big deal for me that kind of like got more international exposure on my artwork. And it's been a really fun run. I've done like a ton of art installations, pre-COVID, obviously. Urban Outfitters had me do like a solo show. So the LA experience has been very great. A lot of locals have been very welcoming, and it allowed me to kind of like create this personal project, which is Comfort Club. It's the clothing brand that I just started about 4 months ago. And really it started off as like a little project I wanted to do to kind of lace my friends with some gear.
I love sweats, first of all. Just,
I know.
Yeah. And then it just became a bigger thing.
I've been following it since the beginning. Yeah. And Dame is a big sweats guy. And I just think of him. And
so when I did my job, I was like, oh, wait. No.
You've already dropped so many collections for just starting out. Like, you have such an awesome variety.
Yeah, I'm kind of like, you know, creating the house style and just laying down a little foundation of an assortment of things that people can really just like fill their wardrobe with. Just like, we're all at the crib now.
Yeah.
And basically it was a quarantine inspired idea as well, because I was really rocking sweats every day. And I was like, all right, like if I'm going to be rocking sweats every day, they got to be fly. And I got to be like really happy to wear them. So
it was last year, yeah. Like at the same time, like I need this color, that color, and that. And like,
exactly. Yeah. And like, I feel like now I have like going out sweats, like workout sweats, like at the home sweats. But really, I just like trying to be comfy. You know what I mean? And it's been a really great project that's been received really well. So I'm keeping it alive. I have really big plans for it. A lot of big collaborations in the works as well. And I just got the new drop off of the capsule that I'm releasing in a couple of weeks today. So this is just like one of the plain crispy logo tees on the charcoal color. So, you know, I just like making like simple stuff that kind of goes with everything right now.
But, and there's candles too. I thought I saw a candle.
Yeah, there's candles. We got silver pendants dropping. I have blankets coming out. Like it's just cozy. It's really like
cozy. I need a blanket for my couch. I need a blanket for my couch. You need the downstairs
blanket. Exactly. I got you. You know, it's going down.
I'm high. This is the best thing I've heard all day.
I like the fresh charcoal. I like the fresh charcoal logo tee. I like that.
Hey, appreciate that, fam.
Like that. I'm a fan of a fresh t-shirt. So
I have to initiate you all into the club for sure.
Whatever we got, dude, man.
Word up. It's a movement, man.
Yeah, appreciate it. That means a lot. It's been really fun, and I think that, you know, everybody deserves to be comfy, looking like clean and stylish. So that's my mission right now. And it's been really rewarding, kind of like seeing these packs go out in the real world and being received by people that I'm not really like, I don't know who they are. So it's like gaining a life a little bit larger than me at this point. And it's wild to see it grow. And I'm just like, I'm riding with it like all the way. So yeah, it's been cool.
That's awesome, man.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, so we got 2 minutes left. Dewey, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Of course.
Yeah, so it's my fun.
Yeah, that was cool. Total like really nice hanging out with the Philly crew too. Being over, I'm in like, you know, Los Angeles in exile from my Philadelphia family. So it's a nice little taste. I'm glad that it's like snowing over there because I'm like, all right, like this is, I get to experience it.
It's like super snowing.
Without being in it.
Yeah.
I was outside stumbling for 2.5 hours.
Are you guys still locked down over there?
Like that much snow was out there.
I mean, honestly, it's like not the, LA lifted the restaurant like lockdown and everything, so you can really like eat like outdoors, but I'm kind of keeping it simple still. Chill. I work from home. I've just been like chilling at the crib and like not really like meeting up with like new people or parties or anything like that. So
that's smart.
Comfort, okay.
Exactly.
Comfort, man.
Yeah. Comfort. Comfortable.
Hey, what's your sign, Dewey, before we go? I have to know. What's your sign?
I'm a Virgo.
A Virgo. Okay, this explains this comfy, cozy. Virgos love to kind of...
yeah, there you go.
Comfortable surroundings. All right, cool.
Yeah, all day. Gotta stay cozy. You know what I mean?
Y'all got a dope song, too. What's that one with Nas and... Ludacris and Dougie Fresh.
Oh.
You ain't never heard that song?
Virgo?
Wait, hold on.
Virgo?
What?
Yo, Google it. Yo, there's a song. Virgo song is Nas, Dougie Fresh, and Ludacris in the joint.
It's my song.
Next review. Next review. The song Virgo. Right.
This is great.
That was awesome. All right, thanks, Dewey. So, per usual, Mr. Jason Bachman's going to play us out over there on the piano.
Yes, Jason.
Okay, J-Dog.
Hey, thanks, guys.
Got to hang for Jay's solo. It's the best part of the show, Dewey.
I'm hanging on, for sure.
Omar for the champagne. Woo! was waiting for those 808s, man. You should have dropped them 808s in there, man.
Yes, Jason.
Should have dropped them 808s in there, man. Voice for the beat. Virgo crew, they be running the streets. So let's go. Let's go. Let's go. For the beat. Let's go. Virgo crew. It's the Virgo. Let's go. Nasty Nas. Let's go. Ludacris. And if you don't know, now you know. Tough touch.